Hey, Dutch Sheets, coming to you again to exhort and encourage you during this incredibly momentous season here in America. It's deja vu all over again for me. I remember this same sort of thing in the Bush-Gore election of 2000 when we just had to pray and pray and pray, and here we go again. By the way, I hope you like my We the People hat. I have my We the People shirt on, too. I'm a walking prophetic act today and a sitting prophetic act. I believe the Constitution is so important that I believe God inspired the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. So anyway, that's just a little fun I'm having. But I want to talk to you a little here today just to encourage the praying church, to exhort, to give you some things to think about, and also just to reiterate what I'm hearing the prophets say and what I'm hearing in my heart. And I'll tell you right up front that I'm hearing that we must persevere. This is not over. We don't give up. We're going to win this. And I want to encourage you with that. So I'm just going to walk through some notes here. As you know, this is sort of an informal format. I don't have it all laid out like I might in a sermon, but just to share a few things from my heart. You know, in my book, Intercessor Prayer, the first four chapters, before I get into the how-tos of praying, I dealt more with some of the theological questions regarding prayer. And one of the things I dealt with in depth was, do our prayers really matter? In other words, and that sounds like a strange question, but there's a subconscious mindset that controls many people, I would say most people, and certainly many Christians, and that is that God is in control, and he's going to do what he wants to do, and in spite of us, he's going to get what he wants, so we don't have to worry about anything, and we comfort ourselves with expressions like, God's in control, God's in control of everything, all things work together for good, and what that does without us realizing it at times is it becomes a demotivator. Rather than being motivated to pray, we subconsciously begin to give ourselves a break and think, well, it's okay, you know, God's going to get it done anyway. But I want to say to you that that's not what the sovereignty of God really means. Is God sovereign? Of course he is, because the word sovereign means all rule or all reign. Sovereign, all authority or all rule. Does he have that? Of course he does. He has all authority. But in God's sovereignty, he has limited himself in many ways to the decisions of we humans. For me personally, my own life, he doesn't just dictate everything that happens to me and everything I get out of life. There are laws of sowing and reaping, cause and effect. When I implement and put in, when I put into practice his principles, when I do what he said to do, I get this. When I don't do that, I get this. So it's completely erroneous to say that everything that happens to me has to be God's will because I'm a Christian. Even the passage about all things working together in good in Romans 8, that has to be interpreted in the overall full context of Scripture, as well as the context of that passage, because when he says that, I often point out to people that that verse begins with the word and. And is a conjunction which connects what's about to be said with what was just said. And that promise that all things work together for the good of those that love God and are called according to his purpose is given in the context of us allowing the Holy Spirit to help us in our intercession. In other words, if you pray and if you allow Holy Spirit to help you in your prayer, show you how to pray, pray through you, pray in the Spirit, all of those things that involve praying in the Spirit or praying according to the Spirit, when we do that, all things work together for good. But it is complete heresy to say that in the life of every Christian, everything that happens works together for their good. Well, that's not true. All things can work together for our good. He wants them to, but there's a part for us to play. So to say that God is in control of everything and that if we don't pray or whatever we do or whatever happens, well, you know, God's will, he's in control, is a heresy. If that were true, that would mean that everything that happens on this planet today is God's will. And we know that's not true. There'll be people raped, murdered. There'll be children starving to death. It would be an incredible insult to God's character to say that everything that happens on this planet is the will of God. It's also erroneous and heresy to say that anybody that's in government is that God put them there because Romans 13 says so. No, that's not what the passage means. It means that God has ordained authority and he's ordained government. But again, it would be an insult to the character of God to say that whatever happens in this election, well, God put them there. Bible says that everybody that's in authority was put there by God. God didn't put Hitler in authority so he could kill millions and millions of people. God didn't raise up and put Mao Zedong in power or Mussolini. And that's just ridiculous to say that. That's not what these passages mean. God doesn't put people in power because knowing that they want to kill babies in the womb, but he's going to put them there anyway because he has some nefarious or some mysterious will to accomplish through them. That's not what the passages mean. Government is raised up by God. Authority is raised up by God. But it doesn't mean that everybody that sits in a seat of authority is there because God put that specific person there. So I just want to say to you, to those of you that hear me right now, your prayers are important. God works through the prayers of his people. That's the other thing that I talk about in depth in the book, Intercessory Prayer, especially at the beginning. I decided years ago when I really began to study prayer and intercession, what I really came to was a decision, a mindset that in me basically was, if I know my prayers matter, I'm going to do it. If they're making a difference, if God needs them, because that's the way he operates, we ask in his name and he uses our prayers to do things. If that's true, I'm going to do this. If it's not true, in other words, if he's just going to do what he wants to do anyway, and my prayer is just some religious activity or something to make me more spiritual or whatever the reason might be, I'm probably not going to be very, very motivated to do this because I'm not all that religious. And I don't want to do it just because somebody says I have to do it to be a good Christian. But if I'm really his partner, if he really is working through me, if we are co-laborers in this endeavor, and my prayers are literally releasing power in the spirit realm when I do it in Jesus' name that allows him to do something, if my authority that he gave me is really releasing his kingdom will into the earth, I'm down for that. So I just want to say right up front to all of you listening, don't allow that subconscious mindset to cause you to not pay the price or do what you need to do in this season. And don't buy into that theology that says, well, God's just in control and he's predestined everything and he's going to get it done anyway. No, God needs our prayers. He's using our prayers. And therefore they matter. And that means, you know, listen, yeah, be a part of prayer meetings. Get on prayer calls. If you know people, some believers, you're part of a home group or you know some people you could call once, twice a week, every day for 5 minutes and get in agreement, do it. But it also means individually. Just simplify it to a few things you need to pray and decree every day. And when you're on that drive to work, you know, don't be distracted from your drive. But hey, you know, when you're going down the interstate and it's safe to do so, just make some decrees. When you're getting dressed in the morning, when you're cooking, make some decrees. You know, even if all of it only adds up to 5 minutes a day, that 5 minutes matter. And if all of us are doing our part, we're going to get this done. So I just want to encourage you and motivate you by assuring you your prayers are doing something. This is not just about God being in control anyway, and it's all automatic, and the sovereignty of God just guarantees that whoever he wants to win is going to win. That's not how it works. The other thing I want to talk about for a few minutes is I want to encourage you that we cannot give up. You know, there are some believers, many believers probably, there are some Christian leaders that are caving. Well, you know, we want unity, and we don't want to, you know, this voter fraud thing, you know, it's not worth it. Let's just move on. And the delegates, you know, Biden has X amount of delegates. We just have to move on. I'm not sure where that's coming from, other than demonic thoughts and suggestions. To say, we know there's been voter fraud, because I know there's been voter fraud. I know from people being in the room watching things happen, let alone all of the accounts from others that I believe in. I know there's been voter fraud. Now, to sit back and say, when we're warring for the soul of a nation, warring for the destiny of a nation, which the destiny of our nation is to be a light for God to the nations of the earth, that we're warring to recapture that. Our destiny is to be the strongest, greatest voice for the gospel of the kingdom to the ends of the earth, and that God's about to bring another great revival, and America is critical in that, to become that voice, to say, and that voice will be weakened with an unrighteous government. I'm telling you right now, that voice will be weakened with an ungodly, unrighteous government. And so to say that, and to say that what government does doesn't matter as far as how God can bless us, that to keep shedding the blood of innocent babies, which defiles the land and brings a curse on us, that God's just going to excuse that and give us our destiny anyway, and that morality doesn't matter, and that we can make unrighteous decisions in the court to redefine the first institution he created on planet Earth, marriage, when he said it's between a man and a woman, he made them male and female, and they're to come together and cleave. And now we feel like we can just redefine that and break that covenant, and that God's just going to bless us anyway and give us our destiny anyway, and that none of that really matters, or that Biden and the Democrats who have ruled him out of their party, booed him at their convention in 4 years ago, and refused to say his name in the Pledge of Allegiance, and that their appointed person, they want to be president, that he believes you can abort babies right up to birth, that's fine, that he believes 8-year-old children should be able to change their gender. This is ludicrous to say it doesn't matter, let's just give up now. And even though this has been a little fraud, hey, let's just back up and give in. I don't know where this comes from. This is utterly ridiculous. And for the other side, the far left, are you saying to me it's okay to check the accuracy of Twitter, but it's not okay to check the accuracy of votes for senators and presidents of the president of the United States? The ludicrousy of what the media is saying to us and the left is saying to us is ludicrous. And I'm sorry that, but for my brothers and sisters out there who are caving and who are saying we just need to move on, or for, you know, Republicans to say, oh, you know, no, we don't want to bring more disunity, and we don't want to do this or that. We just need to accept this. I'm sorry. Just ridiculous. When we are warring for things as weighty as we are warring for, it would be an abomination for us to back up and say, oh, okay, let's just give up. This election has not been called just because the media is calling him president-elect, and the Democrats are calling him president-elect Biden, and he's calling himself president-elect. You need to listen to me. That means nothing. This has not been decided. And we need to fight in war until it has been decided. And I believe it's going to be decided for righteousness. I believe they are going to find thousands and thousands of votes that are not legal.
I believe they are going to find thousands of votes that were cast for President Trump that weren't counted. And I am not willing to back up an inch when I know that we're warring for the reset of this nation, when we have promises from God that I'm resetting this nation and reconstituting this nation and restoring this nation. And when we know that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people, and that breaking God's covenants brings a curse, and the shedding of innocent blood brings a curse, and immorality and worshiping of idols and saying other false gods and religions are okay brings a curse. I am not willing to back up and say, let's just let it happen. Let's just let this, let them have this election and let them reverse the gains that we've made, and let them keep killing babies and let them keep funding abortion around the world. Let me tell you, if Biden steps in as president, the first thing he will do is sign this Mexico Act again, which allows millions upon millions of our dollars to go to abortions or to pay for abortions around the world. Trump stopped it. Bush stopped it. Obama put it back in place. Trump stopped it again because he's been, listen to me, he's been the most pro-life president we have ever had. Which gets me to the next point I'm going to just jump into here. I hear people, some even claiming to be prophets, who are saying that, well, Trump didn't repent enough, so God's removing him and giving this to Biden. As though, number one, I don't believe that he's not repented enough, and I'll get to that in a minute. But to say that this is about Trump, that God does it, all the things I just talked about, the life issue, the marriage issue, the morality issue, the destiny of this nation issue, the preaching of the gospel in an unfettered way because we're under the blessing of God again in this nation, and a government that releases us and doesn't fight us and say you can't gather and tries to take our money and all of these things. The fact that Trump supports all of that and that Biden doesn't, to say that just because maybe they're thinking he hasn't repented enough, so God wants this party that won't name him, that won't submit to him, that doesn't want him to be involved in government, and a man that says he's for these eight-year-olds changing their genders and having operations and taking drugs for that at a young age, and it's okay to keep killing the babies, that God would want that person in power. This is ridiculous. I'm telling you that God does not want that to happen. And I'm telling you that if someone prophesies, if you hear them say that Trump didn't repent enough, so God wants Biden and he's given it to him, I'm saying to you that is absolutely false. That is not God. The prophets that I know, and I know many, the ones that I believe in, trust, hear from God, and all of the words that are coming to me. Listen, if you have any confidence in me whatsoever, all that are coming to me that I bear witness with are that those are not words from God. And that to say that President Trump hasn't repented enough, so God's removing him. Listen, I'm going to say to you, I've watched this man for 4 years. I believe he is changing. I believe he has changed and is changing more. I believe that all of those things in his past that none of us who are true believers and are followers of Jesus and believe the Bible, we don't like a lot of things that he did. But I don't believe he's the same man. Yes, I do believe he's changed. And I've watched him change. And I do believe that when he says things that are toward God or pro-God or calling out to God or wants God's blessing on the nation, etc., and his warming up and coming alongside the church and honoring the church and church leaders, I don't believe it's hypocrisy. I don't believe he's lying. I don't believe that it's phony. I have watched him, and I believe I can say with great, great conviction in my heart, God is changing this man. He's in a process of being transformed. And I believe that process is going to continue. I believe God raised him up. I don't believe God is finished with him. And therefore, I just want to say to you, it is wrong to say, since he hasn't repented enough, God's had it with him and is moving him on. That is not true. Absolutely. 1,000% I can say that is not true. Now, God has spoken clearly through the prophets, and he's shown us over and over and over again. He raised up this man, and I'm confident he wants to give him 4 more years to work in this nation. Listen, if he's not put back in office, you can forget justice taking place in the deep state. You know, the false FISA warrants, the lies on the Russian conspiracy thing, the wrong false impeachments, all the things they make up, the people in the FBI that have lied, that are being researched right, or being checked out right now, efforts being made to find the truth. You can forget justice coming to any of that, because Justice Barr would be removed immediately from that position if Biden wins this, and the investigations would stop, and the exposure of those in our government over the last years, even decades. You can forget that being exposed. Evil is going to continue to take place, because I can tell you right now that will stop. If we don't war and get God's will and God's person back in office. So we need to get behind this in intercession. We need to stay involved. We need to pray for righteousness to prevail. And I'm great with praying and saying, Lord, let's just have a fair count. Let's pray that every fraudulent vote be exposed and every legal vote be counted. I'm great with that, because I believe if it's just the legal votes counted and all the fraud is taken out, I'm confident President Trump is going to win this election. And let me just say one more thing. For any believer, any Christian, anybody else for that matter, but certainly any Christian, to say anything other than that is, to me, sinful. To say we're going to accept cheating and fraud and we're okay with that, and that we don't need all the votes, the right votes counted and the false ones thrown out. It's saying we're okay with sin. We're okay with cheating to get the president of the United States. Can you imagine anything as crazy as that? No, we're praying for a true count. We are praying that every legal vote is counted and that every fraudulent vote is exposed. And I'll go a step farther, that every fraudulent vote, everyone who's discovered that was a part of that is prosecuted and held accountable at the highest level, at the very highest levels. And this man right here, I'm praying for favor on him, and I'm praying that God continues to grab his heart, change his heart, arrest this man, and that he has a holy, powerful encounter with God that takes him to a place he's never been with the Lord, that he becomes passionate for Jesus Christ, a passionate worshiper, a lover of God's word, one who is deeply engaged at a heart level with the Lord, and that his 4 years result in the greatest 4 years of transformation this nation has ever experienced. Now, let me just shift into one more thing I want to say. I want to challenge the praying church. I'm not even talking to those that are nominal, that don't pray, that don't care, that have the que sera, sera attitude, you know, whatever's going to be, we'll go. We just trust God, whatever he wants to. I'm not even talking to that group right now. I'm saying to you, if you are a sincere, true believer and you believe in the power of prayer, that's who I'm talking to. We need to persevere. We don't need to get weary. We cannot have the mindset that's going to grow weary in a week or a few days from now. We're going to have a mindset that the scripture teaches that through faith and patience, we inherit the promises. That this is the confidence that we have, that after we've prayed, that when we don't grow weary in our well-doing, we will reap. When we don't grow weary, when we don't lose heart, the passage in Galatians really means. In other words, we don't give up. If it takes a week, we're in for a week. If it takes a month, we're in for a month. If it takes 2 months, we're in this for 2 months. I've heard some prophets, I've heard two in the last 2 days prophesy that God spoke to them 70 days. They don't know if that, we're not real sure yet. I'm not convinced. Is that symbolic? Because that's a very symbolic number of judging evil in Scripture. You know, and so is that it? One of these prophets really believes it's literal, and that God was saying January 16th before all the breakthrough we need takes place. Chuck Pierce said before all the turmoil is over, and I don't know what all that means. It'll be January 18th. These two figures, the dates very close to each other. I'm saying to you, I don't know when this will end. Even when it ends, the election is announced. Finally, the turmoil won't end. So we just need to have a heart and a mindset that we're in this until. I'm just in the. I've been warring for this nation for 30 years. I'm sure not going to struggle over 2 months or 3 more months or whatever. I'm just in this until, and I'm in this until we win. Don't be discouraged because it hasn't happened yet. Don't be surprised that the enemy is fighting this. Daniel, even though God had heard his prayer for the restoration of Israel and released angels immediately to start working to bring forth the answer to Daniel, Daniel had to fast and pray for 3 more weeks, 21 days, against a principality over Persia before the battle could be won in the invisible realm where the angels were, all the activity was. I'm not pretending to be able to explain all of that. I'm just saying that's what the Bible says. There was warfare in the spirit realm for 3 weeks before the angels could break through it. And that God was using the prayers of Daniel and his fasting, because that's how he works on earth, through people. Not in spite of people, through our decrees, through our intercession, through our prayers, through our obedience. That's how he works on planet Earth. And so it took 3 weeks of that persevering prayer on the part of Daniel. And maybe he had some prayer buddies, I don't know. But it took 3 weeks of that before the angel could finally break through with victory over the principality and say, Daniel, I was sent 3 weeks ago. God started hearing to answer your prayers the first day you prayed. Took us 3 weeks to get through. I'm sure the angel was probably thinking, sure, I'm glad you persevered. I'm sure I'm glad you were still releasing the kind of prayer and repentance and declaration that enabled us to get the job done. Because this is my theology. If he had stopped and given up, he wouldn't have received. Because the Bible is filled with principles, passages, scripture stories that let us know if we don't persevere, if we don't have the patience required, our faith doesn't get what he wants our faith to get, because the Bible is clear. It's through faith and patience we inherit the promises. You know, I've prayed for things for years. I prayed for one girl in a coma for a year, an hour every week. I went and prayed over her. I spent a total 70, 80 total hours over that year decreeing over her, praying over her, interceding over her before God healed her, gave her a new brain. Sometimes you get the answer like this. Sometimes it's a miracle. Sometimes it comes. But sometimes there are factors involved we don't understand, we don't know about. God needs to do this, needs to do that, needs to work on another person, this, that, wants to do it this way because it get him more glory or the victory will be bigger. We don't always know why it takes a while. Sometimes it's just a matter of releasing enough power and authority every time we pray, every time we pray, every time we pray, because Ephesians says he does exceeding abundantly beyond all we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. When you analyze that passage, effectual fervent, the words imply that there is literal power and energy, and spiritually speaking, being released from us as we pray. So as we do it and as we persevere, I believe every time we pray, more power is being released. More of the power of Holy Spirit is being released. More damage is coming to the kingdom of darkness. More is happening to weaken them every time we pray. Because we're not just trying to talk God into it. We're releasing his power. The power of the Holy Spirit in us is being released every time we do it. Angels are being released every time we do it. So I'm saying to you, I'm hearing in my spirit, this is going to take a while. I knew that in the 2000 elections. And my life changed for about 40 days. My prayer life changed. I went on prayer journeys to D.C. and to Florida where they were counting votes. I just had to press in more. Everything changed because I knew I was in an important battle for the nation. You just need to get yourself ready, and your mindset needs to be, I don't care how long this takes. I'm not giving up. I'm not stopping until we get to victory. Or someone else is inaugurated on January 21st or whenever it happens, you know, and I'm not believing for that, but I'm telling you, I'm not stopping until, because the babies are that important to me. What God wants to do in this nation, that important to me. Frankly, this is not about Donald Trump. This is about a person God wants to use, but the God wants to use and what he wants to use them for is really what's important to me. The Republican Party, I'm not doing this for the Republican Party. I'm not doing this for Donald Trump. I'm doing this for the purposes of God in the earth for America. And when we do it for America right now, because of what he wants to do in the earth, this nation is so important. It's not just for America. It's for the nations. When we war for this nation in this election right now, we are not just warring for America. We are warring for a harvest around the world. We are warring for freedom around the world. We are warring for the purposes of the kingdom of God being established around the world. And so there's no quit in me over that. And I know when I do it, I'm doing this for eternal purposes. I'm not doing it for a man. I'm not doing it for a party. I'm doing it for the kingdom of God. I had one or two people answer me on my Twitter page. I want to say to you right now, quit wasting your time sending me things like this. Things like, you know, the insinuation, the way that we're, you know, the election's not that big a deal. We really ought to be warring for souls. Is it really for this election that we should be warring for? How about this is war for the gospel? You have no idea what you're talking about. We are warring for the gospel. We are warring for a great awakening. Why God needs this man in there is not just because of the Republican Party or what I want to see in the way of who is president of the United States. This is about kingdom happenings. This is about the purposes of God in the earth. If you can't see that, you're spiritually blind. Okay. So this is not a political spirit. This is not a political thing for me. I'm in the government because it's important to God, because God is government. And God is the person that all government is supposed to flow through. God is government. But I'm not into the political spirit, and I'm not into politics in that sense. The political thing gets evil, but government is not evil. There are evil people in government, but the principle of government is of God. He is government. He gives and he authorizes and releases his government from the personal level to a family level to corporate levels all the way up to nations. God is in all of that, and he wants righteous government. And for somebody to say this is not important and then we need to get on spiritual matters, you have no understanding whatsoever of what the Bible teaches about government and righteous government. So I guess maybe I'm just a little too intense. Maybe I should have calmed down a little before I did this podcast today or this video. But listen, this is important. This is important. This is not just about an election and who's going to be president for the next 4 years. When the church backed off in the 60s and 70s and said, who cares what the court does? Who cares about education? We're going to get raptured out here anyway. Or, if it's a mistake, we'll just get it turned around. Listen, it has taken us 50 years, 60 years for some of this stuff from when they took prayer out of the schools. 50 years thereabouts, the abortion decision. Some of these things, because of God limiting himself to the decisions we make on planet Earth, some of the stuff he can't just turn around overnight. If we miss what he wants to do right now, it could be another generation, 40, 50 years before, again, before God could do what he wants to do. When the generation that came out of Egypt and Israel got into unbelief and didn't have the patience, faith and patience to get done what they needed to do, they did not get God's will. The sovereignty of God did not just give it to them anyway. He had to wait 40 years for another generation. So this, what we're doing right now is so important. You are warring, let me tell you, you are warring right now for your kids and your grandkids and your great grandkids. You are praying. What your prayers are doing are stopping. We in the last 4 years, we have stopped the evil momentum. We have stopped the decline. We have halted the powers of darkness that were leading this nation completely away from God and a loss of our destiny and to an apostate nation. That has been stopped. Now we are trying, and God has said, I've reset this nation. Now we must keep things positioned to continue to move forward into his restoring, his revival, and his outpouring of Holy Spirit and our destiny into the nations again of this gospel. What we are warring for is, there's just no way to overstate it. So this is worth missing some meals over. This is worth getting up early and praying. This is worth getting to the prayer meeting or getting on the prayer calls. This is worth disciplining yourself with some prayer requests and decrees that you're going to make every day. This is worth not listening to the evil reports like the 10 spies that came out of Egypt and said, or Israel, Canaan, and said, we can't do this. The giants are too big. Or Biden's already won. The count's already in. No, it's not. And stop listening to the evil reports, including Fox, and just listen to what God says, and don't give up until it's really decided. So it's worth the price you pay, and you need to persevere. And we're going to there's going to be a remnant that perseveres. And I and others are going to be doing things like this 4 or 5 times a week. And we're going to send the appeal to heaven prayers out, the give him 15 prayers out every day. And we're going to keep people engaged, and we're going to keep encouraging you with what God's saying. And we're going to war this thing through to the end. And we're going to see the kingdom of God rule in this cause, this election, and we're going to see his will be done. And I would say to leaders, I'll just end with it, to the leaders that are hedging your bets. Well, you know, I believe there's probably been a little fraud, and maybe God's going to work in this. But if he doesn't, then we just get behind Biden and pray for him. Listen, make a stand, okay? Make a stand. If you believe there's been fraud, stand up and say, there's been fraud. We go no farther. That's the way we're going to pray. We go no farther until every vote, legal vote, is counted and false ones are thrown out. And quit hedging it with but. Just say what the truth is and motivate your people to pray. Don't give them a little out. Well, whatever God does. What kind of stand is that? That's no kind of stand. There wouldn't even be an America if 250 years ago righteous preachers had not made a righteous stand and say, we're going to fight for freedom. So, I have just zero tolerance and respect for this mamby-pamby, I think this, but whatever. Get before God long enough till you believe, till you know what you really believe, and then tell us what you really believe. What is God really saying? Was there fraud? If so, are we going to fight or not? Is Trump God's choice or not? It's time to make a stand. There's too much at stake here. I'm not willing to walk into heaven through the blood of 60, wading through the blood of 60 million more aborted babies. I'm just not willing to do that. And God is just not going to tolerate it. So make a stand. Tell us what you really believe. Get on one side or the other. Definitely. So everybody knows what you believe, and do it. And if you don't have backbone enough to do that, then go get a job doing something other than preaching the gospel or being a voice for God in the earth. I'm sorry, but that's just what I believe. I hope that doesn't sound mean spirited. That's just what I believe. And I believe that's what came out of my spirit under the anointing of Holy Spirit. Make a stand. Make a stand. We must make a stand right now. Lord, I pray over your people that there would be something that rises up in them that says, yes, I will stand. And yes, I will pray. And pastors and leaders that will say, yes, I will make a stand. I'll make a stand. I'm not afraid of losing people. I'm not afraid of losing money. I'm not afraid of the IRS. I'm not afraid of anything. I know who's on the side of God and who isn't, and I'm going to say who that is. And Lord, and that they will make that bold stand. Fearlessly, they will do it. And then, Lord, I pray for this prayer army. Infuse your strength into them. Bring that fruit of patience, perseverance, that strength right up out of their spirit. Cause them to be strong in the Lord, in you, Lord, in the power of your might. Cause them to be those that never waver, that never lose heart, but just keep persevering. And Lord, just keep them engaged. I pray if you're one of them listening to me right now, I pray strength into you. I pray discouragement out of you. I say the evil report of the evil spies that are saying the giants are too big. You're not going to listen to that report. You're going to listen to Joshua and Caleb. You're going to listen to the, we are well able to do this. We are well able to do this. We're going to take the giants. We're going to do this. Lord, I pray that mindset into them and that kind of strength. I pray clarity of thought, that they won't listen and be confused by news reports, that they'll only listen to what is truly legal and what is the truth, not to what the media says. The media has no authority. You know, I know that, Lord. The media has no authority to decree who the president is. I pray that your people don't listen to that. I pray that those voices become weaker and weaker and weaker, and the praying church listens to you, your will, and what the prophets are saying. I bless your people with strength. I bless our president. I speak strength into him, strength into his team, strength into his legal team. I ask you to give them all the resources financially that they need, the wisdom they need. I pray for the Supreme Court. Lord, I know this is going to get there. I know the president is going to be taking this there. In fact, by the time people watch this, he will have already, I believe, been there once. Lord, I pray that Supreme Court makes the right decisions every time, righteous decisions every time, constitutional decisions every time. I pray that no fear is on them, no wrong thinking is on them. I pray that demons are not allowed in that courtroom. I pray the blood of Jesus covers that courtroom and angels are there, and that those justices are only make decisions that would honor you, honor the Constitution, and that are righteous decisions and honor truth. Honor justice. Lord, that's what I pray. That's what I believe. I decree your Supreme Court, the Supreme Court will be blessed by you to make the right decisions. I pray these things in Jesus' name, and I thank you, Lord, for your victory in this situation. Amen. Thank you for listening to me today. I appreciate you. Stand.
Thank you for listening to this podcast from Dutch Sheets Ministries. If you would like more information about us, or if you've been impacted by this podcast and would like to sow into the ministry, please visit our website at dutchsheets.org.